live here. Right. Hopefully that gets us going. And I'll just jump into the question you asked me as soon as I double check that we're live. All right, stream config is excellent. So
already looking better.
All right, so basically you just asked me what I thought about my PlayStation TV, and I don't like it at all, to be honest with you. my main problems with it are that I feel like I have to run it a wired network to get acceptable levels of input latency. So I guess it depends on what game I'm playing, but like if I have it in my bedroom, which is just like that, my house is set up where my office is here. There's a set of stairs here, and then my bedroom is like, you know, basically the next room over. There's so much latency between on Wi-Fi between those two spots that I can't play a game like Destiny or a shooter or something like that on my PlayStation 4. So it doesn't really work for me in that way. I do like that you could load like Vita games and PSP games onto it, but I don't find that there's that many Vita games that I feel compelled to use. So overall, I bought it when it was relatively new. I think it was like $100 or $130.
$100, yeah.
And I really have rarely used it. I don't find that the Vita does that well either. Like the trying to play your PS4 on your Vita, like that doesn't really work well.
A little cumbersome.
I did, as a test, actually run a wire, like a Ethernet wire from my router, which is right here next to me, to the bedroom just to see if that would improve it. And it did tremendously. But my Wi-Fi is strong. Like I got good Wi-Fi game up in here. I am not fucking around. So there is no reason that my Wi-Fi shouldn't be able to handle that shit.
Let me ask you a question. When was the last time you used it? Has it been 6 months, maybe?
Yeah, it's probably been at least 6 months.
Okay, because
you sound like a new update for it. Anyone announce your robot right now?
We basically got the latest update, and like I said, she got stuff from Russia. And she said FIFA. I didn't see her do it, but some guy in Russia was playing FIFA, and he was like, "Holy shit! Somebody took over my PS4."
All right, Beastly, we can't hear you at all, so we're gonna move on to the next. What you've been playing? Sorry, Beastly, I don't mean to cut you off, but I can't hear you. Yeah,
I'll jump in. So it's been a while since I've been here, but I've been playing Blade and Soul, and that game is a lot of fun. That game, it's funny because that game originally came out 2012, I believe. It's a 2012 game. And now we get like the 3.0 version here in the U.S. or North America, and the game it's a lot of fun. It's kind of funny that it's so old, but yet it's such a fun game. And it's so much. I think it's just a combat system in the game that makes it fun. You know, it's not like an ordinary MMO because I don't like MMO or anything like that. But I've been enjoying it a lot. Like I actually got a mouse, so I'll show you guys that real quick. So if you see that, I got an MMO mouse.
Razer. I've seen that at Best Buy. Very impressive.
These are awesome. Like this alone with that game, like my combos. I play Kung Fu Master, so like it's all about combos and stuff with that character. So using those button layouts on the mouse is so much better. I'm gonna do unboxing and also a review for that. It's a lot of fun though. So definitely check that out. I'm playing Street Fighter V, like I said before, but. You know, I've been playing it more offline with friends and stuff like that. Like, and I did the story mode, I think, or whatever they want to call it now. I did that in, I don't know, like 40 minutes or so, maybe an hour. I don't remember. I beat all of them already. And the funny thing about that is there's no level difficulty. So it's just one
level. Yeah, which is whack. Yeah, it's super whack. Oh, yeah, it's so whack.
I don't even think that's easy. That would be like very easy. Because usually, like, Street Fighter has, like,
They don't even block. They don't even block. Like, you could just keep pounding on. They don't even block or parry or any of that shit.
That's my kind of story mode right there. They hate you at all.
If you don't move sometimes, like, they won't even make a first move. They're waiting for you to make a move. So it's kind of – but whatever.
It's also like my perfect woman right there. That's a lie. Funny. That's not true.
Yeah, that game is a lot of fun. I mean, Street Fighter V is fun, and, you know, I'm sure it's going to get even better later on, but, you know, I knew what I was getting into when I got the game.
What am I hearing right now?
Like a gerbil laughing or something.
Lord, please give that man bandwidth.
Oh, man. Episode 100 going off without a hitch.
This is going great. Someone throw bandwidth his way, please.
Yeah, right. You're the only one with any despair, so it's going to have to be you.
Hold on, let me call Fios real quick. Hold on, Beastly, we got you.
Inner Black Ninja, what have you been playing?
I've been playing a little bit of everything. I beat Unravel. I beat Firewatch. I'm playing Street Fighter. And I tried to play Fallout like for 3 days straight. And man, I'm sorry. I'm never going to fucking beat that game. I might as well just throw it in the garbage.
That's really bad.
I'll give them credit, though. Ever since the patch, it looks a lot better, and the draw distances are better, and you notice that, and it runs better. But the game is just so – I wish they could patch in a story. That would be awesome, and then I might play it.
Am I the only person to beat that game here? Like, who else beat that?
I played a ton of that.
Yeah, well, you beat it on PS4?
Xbox One?
Okay.
Yeah.
Cool. I got PC. But yeah, it's fun, but I feel like they did nothing different. But it was something to do at the time I beat it. I guess that's all it really comes down to. But what else have you been playing now?
No, that's been it. I played a little bit of Call of Duty the other day. And then other than that, it's just been on and off with all types of different games that are like newer. Like I beat Firewatch was a great game. If you got like 4 hours to kill, play that one. Hello, what do you want?
Episode 100, everyone.
Pretty good so far.
Okay. Episode 100, we're killing it.
It's my niece. It's my niece right here. Hello. Say hi. Aww. Say hi right there. Right there.
Hi.
Say
hi. All
right, go away.
Go ahead, get out of here.
Beat it's a kid. Yeah, give me a sip of that smoothie before you go, though.
Yeah,
I want that smoothie too. Like, damn it.
No, yeah, but Firewatch is – I highly recommend any – it's kind of sad, though. It's a really, like, deep game. It's like, damn, man. Like, they started out, it's like Ori, like, to the point of where, like, you're like, damn, it's deep.
Where was I?
Okay, I'm sorry, guys. I'm, like, adjusting everybody's camera now that Beastly's gone.
Yeah, I was just going
to
tell you about
that. So I'm half paying attention to what you're saying, half trying to make the stream look okay.
Beastly camera, why?
You want to start with one of the topics? Another topic?
No, definitely want to talk about what I've been playing because I'm really excited about it.
Ooh.
Robbie, do you want to go first?
Obviously, I played Division, and I beat the little story, the little whatever add-on mission.
Yeah, so you got like a second look at like a new mission, right?
Does it look any different to anyone that's played it?
It looks crisper. It looks a little sharper to me.
Everyone that we played with was like, it looks better. It looks like it's running better, which I'm all for.
You know what? Actually, it's funny you say that because I wasn't going to talk about the Division, but it makes sense now that the beta is running, is that I logged in and I was fully expecting to just like play a whole weekend's worth of the Division.
Me too.
But I played through the first mission. Like I replayed through it and I'm like, you know, you were ringing in my head, Inner Black Ninja, like, do I really want to do this? Do I really want to like start replaying this so many times that like by the time the game comes out, I just like want to burn through it because I played it so many times.
Yeah.
And then you know, I still got this second mission that's fresh. Do I really want to play that? So I decided, you know what? I played enough that I believe that I'm going to get that bonus for playing the beta. But I didn't ruin anything else that's going to be in the full game. And I kind of feel like I took a step back this weekend. I really didn't play much at all this weekend. And I'm okay with that decision right now.
And I do believe that that hurt Destiny in the long run because of the amount of content that they had in their alpha and in their beta. It's like you showed people, like you said, a quarter of the game, technically. You showed them that. And they played it. Not to mention, they played it twice because people get hooked on that shit, man. And they want to play it as much as they possibly can, which I get. But
another thing about the Division that's really got me worried at this point is that, you know, now I've played through that first mission. I must have played through it a dozen times, right?
Yep.
In the first beta, I was just looting that last boss, Hutch.
Yeah.
And so I just play it on hard mode over and over again. There's not a whole lot of gameplay variety there.
No.
Right? You kind of feel like you go in there, you just kind of push ahead, you shoot a lot of bullet spongy guys. There doesn't seem to be a ton of enemy variety. We haven't seen the whole game, so that's really, you know, obviously we can't say that yet, but in like comparing it to Destiny, where I feel like I go in the same strike, I played those strikes hundreds of times, but I can go in there, I can play it with a sniper rifle and a hand cannon, and it feels completely different than when I play it with a you know, a shotgun and a pulse rifle, right?
Yeah.
Like, depending on what secondary weapon I'm using, depending on what special weapon I'm using, shit, Beastly's back
all your hard
completely fuck everything up.
That's just going to screw everything up again.
But yeah, I mean, I'm really worried about how that game is going to play out, like, long term.
I'm worried about that game because it looked better. You're right, by the way. Intergalactic Ninja, it looked better second time around on PC. I'm just letting you know, PC looked awesome. But the thing I'm worried about is it's sort of like Destiny in a way that, even though it seems like it's sort of like MMO style, it's still very linear because, like, you still are supposed to go in certain areas, like, and they sort of direct you where you're supposed to go to. And, like, I mean, I'm okay with it, but it just seems like there might not be as much to do. And I'm hoping there's bigger areas and different places to go to. Because that's what I'm kind of worried about. Because it does seem like you're going this path, and you really can't go your way. You have to go directly where they want you to go, sort of. And I noticed that when I was playing it, which I was shocked by. I mean, it's not that anyone told me that you could go anywhere. I just thought the way it looked, like, you could sort of walk a different way, but you really can't.
Well, it's an open world game, but the missions feel very, like, straight ahead and narrow. Like, it doesn't feel open world when you're playing a mission.
Mm-hmm.
It only feels open world when you're out roaming around.
Yeah.
Which I don't know if that is a success or a failure. We'll have to – I really think we'll have to see what happens with that game
when
it comes out.
The funny thing that happened was when I signed on, my buddy already beat the first mission. So I didn't have to do that anymore. So I jumped in.
Oh, really?
We just ran straight to the second mission. He's like, do you want to get your medic stuff? I was like, I don't care as long as you have it.
I'm sorry, guys. I came in a little late. What game were we talking about here?
Division. The Division beta again.
Oh, okay. The new beta.
Yeah.
All right. That beta ends today, correct?
Yep.
Yes, today's the last day. And I agree with you guys completely that I literally have played almost nothing of this beta. Like, I honestly really wanted to play the new mission that came out. And then I was good. I'm like, I've already experienced this. I don't want to burn myself out on this game. So I'm going to wait for the full version to come out and enjoy it as much as I can.
And so also, how does that make you feel about the full release? The fact that we're thinking about burnout when we're playing the beta.
That's not a stark contrast from the way it was with Destiny. Every Destiny beta, everybody was in it.
But I think we kind of learned a lesson, like Interblack Ninja said, about when we did that with the Destiny, is that we kind of burn ourselves out on at least the first couple of missions.
That's also why I didn't play the Dark Souls 3 beta. Like, I got invited to that and I didn't play it because I didn't want to see any of that game because I'm going to be, like, hooked on it like crack. I don't need to see it.
Yeah, that's a good point.
Look, I'll put it this way. It's Ubisoft, okay? I really don't care what the beta looks like, the alpha. I don't really care. I know all I care about is day one because it's Ubisoft. And that's all. I can't wait till if something's going to happen, like a disaster.
That's true.
You can't log in.
Are you getting it on PC too?
Yeah, I'm getting it on PC.
Yeah, you should be super fucking worried then.
Yeah.
No kidding.
Fuck by any Ubisoft game on PC.
Oh god, that's gonna be a headache.
PC fail.
All right, Robbie, what have you been playing?
I already said.
Oh, I'm sorry. Okay, I can go now. It's my turn. All right.
So, episode 100, guys.
Check this out. Like, I'm really excited what I've been playing because last week, it's Sunday now. On Thursday, I'm also in the Planet Destiny podcast. And Planet Destiny challenged Crucible Radio, another Destiny-themed podcast, to the podcast showdown. So what we did is we queued up so that we'd both be in it together, but we played after the podcast. Now, we stopped recording that podcast at about 11 o'clock, and that match was going to go till about 1 o'clock, 2 o'clock in the morning. So I was like, it's a 3v3. We have four hosts for the podcast. I step back. I'll let the other three guys do it. But I ended up watching the whole thing. Planet Destiny goes down 2-0 right away, right? Loses the first two matches. They come back and they win one. While they're winning that one, our third player gets completely crushed. His internet goes out. Like, it's gone. He can't talk. He can't play. He can't do anything. I'm still there, but I'm like half asleep.
Bring in the substitute.
They bring in the bench, right? They brought in the bench.
Time out.
They bring
Jordan
me in.
In Space Jam.
They bring me in, and while we're waiting, we have a bunch of like Destiny PvP players, like known PvP players, like Luminosity and KJ Hovey, a bunch of guys, Triple Rec, in our Discord chat, just like kind of talking us up, giving us prep, giving us some info, and telling us, you know, how to be a better PvP teammate. So I come in, we go 2-0, win the match for Planet Destiny, and it's one of the best highs I've ever had in a game. And I got to tell you, that game does not have custom matches. It doesn't have private matches. So to set up a game, if you want to play another team, you basically have to just go into the same game type and basically hope to get matched up. You're on voice chat. You're hitting go at the same time. You're hitting launch at the same time. And then you see if it matches up against the other team. If it doesn't, then you back out. You go back in. You try again. It actually took us like 40 minutes to get matched up for the first time.
Wow.
Then when we lost a player, we had to pull back out. It took us another like 20 minutes to get matched up. So Destiny, man, I got to tell you, it was so much fun playing like a match against people I know. Because the only thing more fun than taking down like Oryx or Crota or Atheon with my friends is shooting those motherfucking friends in the face in the Crucible. Like, that's the only thing that's more fun than that. So it was a really fun experience. It was really cool to play against the Crucible Radio guys. I had a blast. But it kind of opened up, like, this is what Destiny could be doing. Why the fuck aren't they doing this, man? It was a really fun experience, but a really frustrating experience at the same time.
So at the end of this match, what time was it?
2:30 in the morning.
Wow.
Yeah.
It's dedication prayer.
And then I was like, I was so amped that I couldn't go to bed till, or I couldn't go to sleep till like 3:34.
Hey, yeah. Right. Just pacing at the bottom of the bed.
You got to be a little careful when you say stuff like that on a podcast. You're like, that's one of the best highs I ever had in the game.
And trust me, guys, I know what I'm talking about here.
I've been pretty high before.
Oh, my God.
So, yeah, I was really excited about that. It was super fun to come in off the bench, secure the win for my team. I was really excited about it.
Well, the way that you play Destiny, why would they have you on the bench in the first place?
I am not the strongest PvP player on that podcast, trust me.
Damn.
Holtzman is by far the best, I would say. Tefty's a strong second. And Pope Bear set up the match.
Wow.
And those guys are all West Coast.
All right, so we got some news, guys.
Let's do it.
You just want to chat? Where are we at? You know, I had to step away. My internet was screwing me over.
Yeah, it's all good. I think we're good for news here.
All right. Just starting the news, Beastly.
First story of the week. Id Software says the campaign for Doom will take most players around 13 plus hours to complete. And then, of course, there's going to be multiplayer with this game as well. First of all, I'm going to say I'm fucking excited for this game. I love Doom. This game looks awesome. And this campaign length is perfect for me. Good.
Did anybody in this podcast play Doom for the single player campaign, or did everybody play it for multiplayer?
I never played the multiplayer of the original Doom. Okay. Only the single player.
I always played single player.
You always played single player?
Original? Well, you talk about original? Which Doom?
Doom 2.
Doom and Doom
2 is where I kind of joined
parties.
Up into
I play LAN parties. Like, that's
yeah,
what
I did
thing,
too.
Yeah.
Well, see, for me, I have kind of an awkward circumstance. I didn't have a PC, and Doom came out on PlayStation 1. I actually still have the disc, and that was my first time ever trying a game like that, and I fell in love with it. And then they released Doom 2 on PS1, and that was my foray into Doom.
Did it have? No, it wouldn't have had multiplayer on PS1.
No, it was no multiplayer, but I didn't even know it had multiplayer. I wasn't a PC gamer, and so for me, just going through and playing the single player campaign, it was just so much to do. It blew my mind.
For me, Doom has never had like a very good campaign, and I know that's probably gonna piss off a lot of people. But, I mean, it was revolutionary because it was the first time you really got to explore, like, a world in 3D. But, there's really no story to it. You were fighting kind of these generic-looking demons.
I agree.
There were jump scares, but they were mostly because, like, a monster closet would open up when you crossed a threshold, and it was always, like, meant to open behind you. Like, the campaign in a Doom game, I can't think of one campaign in a Doom game that really got me excited.
Doom 3, it actually had a pretty decent campaign for the original Xbox.
You can't duct tape a flashlight onto a fucking gun, and then fuck your campaign.
I think they did a really good job at the fun factor in those games. Like, they were fun as hell to play.
Yeah, they did.
And I think that's the same thing that this game is going to do based off of, like, the way the weapons look. And the game looks super fucking pretty, too.
It does look really good.
The game looks amazing.
But I'm more looking forward to the multiplayer in Doom. I want to see what they're going to do with multiplayer. Get that kind of id, fast action, first-person shooter back. We haven't had that in a while.
They got
Quake
a custom
3 Arena and
custom map building, too. You can build your own map in this game, which is going to be crazy.
See, that makes me very happy.
The old Doom, though, the campaigns were all about, like, it was just, like he said, fun. But that's also, like, it was difficulty. So, like, when you got better, you did, like, hardcore mode and, like, just plow through people. If you could beat that, you got more props. Like, that's, the old school one.
To be totally honest, when I played Doom on PS1, I didn't even acknowledge that there was a story. I just went into these maps, and there was tons of enemies to kill. And like you said, Hector, it got tough the further and further you got in. And my brother would sit and watch. It was just a ton of fun.
And the weapons were cool, too. You know, like, you started off with that pistol. You got a shotgun. The double barrel shotgun.
Double barrel in Doom 2.
You move yourself up to the BFG, and you're like, BFG, isn't that big fucking gun? Oh my god, how raw is that? That's fucking nasty.
Have you guys got a chance to play like the original Doom that was modded on PC? Like, they have like some that people did that it's actual first person shooters.
You can look up and down.
So they redid the original Doom, but you could move around and stuff and made it more challenging and stuff. So
that's something that my brain had forgotten. I read a story about Doom, probably it was like 3 or 4 years ago, and they were talking about how in Quake you could finally like move up and down the cursor. I'm like, oh yeah, I forgot that you couldn't do that in Doom.
that's like the way you control GoldenEye. Go try to play that shit now.
Oh god, that game. I did. That was actually a long time ago that I did that, and I was like, oh my god, this game is garbage now.
Thank God for dual analogs.
Yeah.
That was a big innovation.
I'm wondering when the multiplayer beta is supposed to start up, too, because this game is coming out May 17th. You've got to figure the beta's got to be happening soon, too. Within a month or two, I think.
I thought they were talking about in March.
Yeah, it's got to be. It's got to be really soon. I can't wait to play the multiplayer. I mean, Doom is going to be awesome.
Okay. Well, moving on, guys, to more hard drive news. The Division file size on Xbox One has been revealed to
be... Old.
That's old. Quantum Break for PC will not
down
be available
more.
On.
I've been bamboozled. Where did I get these notes from, Robbie?
Scrolled up too far.
Scroll down, and then you'll see the second.
Same conversation from last week. Quantum Break for PC will not be available on Steam and will instead be a Windows Store exclusive.
BC was about to be like deja vu.
This sounds
Nintendo
familiar.
Is releasing the Super Nintendo. Old news.
I got a couple things to say about this. All right, I think it's great on Microsoft. So we're talking about Microsoft alone as a company. I think this is a great move by them. They're selling it on their site only, which it's iffy downloading it, by the way, but that's another thing. Like, at least for Microsoft part, it's good. They get the full money. They don't have to give out to Steam or anything because Steam always gets a percentage when you sell it on their site. So that's a plus. The bad thing I want to say is Quantum Break for a PC. Like, I don't think it's super bad. Like, every, you know, diehard Xbox fans are having a heart attack over here. You know, it's really not that serious. You have a struggling console, like, and it's not struggling by, you know, compared to Xbox 360. I'm just saying, like, compared to its competitor right now, it's struggling to keep up, you know. So don't think that it's not doing well, because it is. It's doing better than the 360 did at this time. The point is that a competitor is doing better. But the problem that I see with this whole thing is that Microsoft realize that they need to make money, right? They're not making as much money as they should be with these exclusive or, you know, these third parties that they paid to make money on the console. So what are they doing? They're trying to add another exclusive, which is for PC. You know, that's the Microsoft exclusive. The problem I see with this is that I don't see Microsoft trusting the Xbox brand as much as they used to. And the reason why I think this is a problem is because people forget Microsoft has a lot of money. And that's usually people say, oh, they have money, they don't have to worry about it. Why do you think a company like that has money? It's because they know when to get rid of something when the stock is high. So that's why, to me, it's kind of shaky that they're giving up that easily, because if they're not supported by PC either, if PC gamers won't buy their games either, then it's not going to look good for their exclusives at all. And that's why I'm sort of worried, because, you know, I don't want Microsoft, Xbox, or anything to disappear either, because then you're just left with one, or I guess one and a half
Just a PC.
Fuck you to Nintendo right there at the end.
I like Nintendo. They'll be back with the NX. But I'm just saying, like, then you're left with, like, less competition. And that's the only reason why I think it's worrisome. But before we started this, Inner Black Ninja said that more people will play, and that's better. I completely agree. It's better for us in general, but is it better for Xbox name? That's what I'm worried about. Like the Xbox brand itself, you know?
So no, I think right now they're realizing that they're at such a deficit between them and the PlayStation 4. There is no fucking coming back. There is no comeback. They're not going to make up that number, man. So we're going to put our game on as much shit as we possibly can. And they're probably going to do that with every game from this point on, to be honest with you.
If you get an exclusive that goes to both a PC and a Xbox, and then you release that, hey, this Microsoft exclusive sold 15 million copies, isn't that going to attract other developers to Microsoft, you know? Maybe it's not just an Xbox exclusive, but you're basically developing on a PC when you're developing it on Xbox, right? So you're just
for you.
I
it seems like a no-brainer to me for Microsoft to like cross market. Like when we get an exclusive, it doesn't mean you're putting the exclusive out on just the Xbox. You can put it out on PC as well. We'll market it for you in the Microsoft Store. You get the console gamers on Xbox, and you know, you get the combined sales of both of those platforms when you do a Microsoft exclusive. I think that's smart business for Microsoft to do.
I totally agree. I think that the future for Xbox is PC. I think that they're trying to marry these two together to kind of enhance the brand so that when people who play PC games that are Xbox exclusives, it'll still have that name or that feel of Xbox to it, even though you played it on PC.
Well, you see,
is it enhancing the brand, though? Like, it doesn't feel like it is to me.
I'm talking about as this progresses. I think that's what their plan is. I don't think that, like Inner Black said, I think that it's too late for them to come back from this deficit. I think they want to make it look better by including the PC in their Xbox exclusive games library so that more people have a chance to play it. And people who do play it will still associate those PC games with the Xbox brand.
You guys remember that one company a long time ago that did this? They moved over different platforms as well. They were called Sega, and they switched to software only. And that's why I think it's kind of dangerous when you see companies start to bring their own thing. I know this is still theirs. You know, Microsoft still owns, obviously, like Windows, you know. But I feel like once you start spreading exclusive that's meant for one console to another platform, like, if you see you're making money off that, what's stopping you from going ahead from another platform? And that's the thing, like, I don't know. You know, like, the thing that was scaring me, which I almost, it's not confirmed yet, but it's really close, is Gears of War. If you see games like Gears of War going to PC, that's when you're starting to see, like, what is the need to buy Xbox One? If you haven't already, what is the purpose of buying an Xbox One?
I can tell you what the purpose of buying an Xbox One, even if you have a PC, it's a nice living room box, right?
Mm-hmm.
And especially if they did something like cross-buy that Sony has done with Vita. Like, imagine if you could cross-buy a game on your PC and on your Xbox. This probably works better for arcade games than it does for, like, full big.
They already did some, though, cross-buy. It's for the
Quantum Break's going to be.
That's perfect, because then you can play it in your living room, or you can play it in your, you know, on your PC setup. And, like, the Xbox, not everybody can afford a gaming PC. You know, it's an expensive thing. So, a lot of people, the Xbox and the PlayStation are aspirational items. There's, when I talk about Destiny 2 on my channel, I have a ton of comments that are like, well, if they make it for not 360 and PS3, I can't buy it because I'm still on that generation. And there's these are still aspirational products. They're still expensive in the mind of a lot of people. So, there is still a use for the Xbox One and the PS4, even though PC gamers might say, oh, they're outdated, old pieces of shit. They're still more powerful than the 360 and the PS3 were.
The PS4 and the Xbox One are just more practical boxes, and they're going to last 6 or 7 years. You don't have to do any type of upgrades. All the games that come out for these consoles that are going to be PC compatible, like they release some PS4 games on PC. Street Fighter V, perfect example. You might have a PC last week that wasn't powerful enough to play Street Fighter V. But if you have a PS4, no matter if you buy Street Fighter V now or buy a game 3 years from now on PS4, it's going to play because it's more of a practical box. And like, so that's the value of having these consoles over PCs.
Beastly, and like you said, they're going to integrate them both. Well, right now, when you play your Xbox and you pop an achievement on there, it comes pops up on your PC too. Yep. You know, and it's going to be towards the aspect of if you want to play with people on Xbox One and you have a PC, you're going to be able to do that. You're going to it's going to just be combined together. Yeah, you might have to pay for Xbox Live, which bam, making more money off of that to be able to play with your friends. You know. They're gonna make money one way or another. They're printing money no matter which way it goes. It's just smart for them to do that.
More than likely, if this is successful for Microsoft, they're gonna make the Xbox brand the dominant, not over Steam, but when it comes to just the Windows brand, the dominant gaming platform. People who play like you said, whenever I pop an achievement on my Xbox One, bam, pops up right on my screen. It just feels at home. It feels like it's a part of my system.
And it's just another avenue, I think, to fight that console war against Sony, right? It's like, you buy a game on Xbox, you also get it on PC. You can play it wherever you want. You can play it on your fucking Windows tablet, you know?
Yeah.
Like, these are compelling arguments that Microsoft is making, even though their software fucking sucks.
I think it's genius, to be honest. Yeah. I think it's a genius move.
And in their fight against Macintosh and Apple, it's another big plus. It's like all these games that you love to play on your Xbox, you can also play on your PC if you get rid of that stupid Macintosh you have.
And this could also just be them stating that Alan Wake sold good on PC too, because it actually did sell really good on PC. So maybe that's why they're bringing Quantum Break over, made by the same dude. So they might be like, hey, like this will sell just as good, or they're just gonna like literally shit can the Xbox. Like, there's.
I love every argument that we've made about this, like from the beginning. Like, I love it. I love it all, and I think devil's advocate could be made for anything here. But I think it'll be really interesting to see what Microsoft does with this in the future.
Do you guys see Gears going though? Gears 4.
Yes, because Gears is already on PC, but it took a while. I see him being released the same day.
How about Halo?
Oh,
Halo 5 will come on that. Maybe at some point. Because I feel
Halo,
like
they used to make Halo games for PC.
Yeah, and I feel like
they were good.
I feel like even with Gears 4, I think it's probably going to be a timed exclusive on Xbox One. They're going to do, you know, they're going to come out and say this is an Xbox One exclusive. I bet you they're already developing a PC version. Guaranteed.
Their event is this week, right? The Microsoft event where they're supposed to be announcing a lot of shit like this.
I think so. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Definitely though. I think they're. Xbox and PC is kind of their future, cementing those two platforms.
Did any of you guys pre-order Quantum Break to get the free PC version? I did.
I pre-ordered it long before that shit was announced. I pre-ordered it like 5 months ago.
You don't want that PC Master Race version?
Oh, sorry. I've been drinking, so I might have a propensity to swear a little bit more than usual.
My pirate
Briar,
comes out.
Let me just say this, Briar. You're the only one who hasn't really fully given themselves over to the dark side. Inner Black, Robbie, Not Too Nerdy Entertainment, and Beastly Gamer are all playing PC
Master
games.
Master Race.
This is happening.
I don't need to explain again why I don't play PC games. I've explained it plenty of times before right here on the podcast. I just don't like dealing with driver issues. I don't like Windows. I don't like having to upgrade my PC every couple of years with a $500 graphics card.
An old man, Briar. Get with the times.
Briar. Just like
it's true. I was doing all this in the late 90s, early 2000s. I got fucking sick of it, and I don't really care about it anymore.
Briar.
I'd rather just hop in a game
and sit back
and relax.
Briar, I just want to let you know before anyone else, you know, before you find out later, you know, you're a nice guy and everything. Destiny 2 is going to be a PC exclusive, so you might as well get PC now.
All right, I am ready to embrace the PC Master Race.
That won't get
us
over.
That's my whole
All hail our Microsoft overlords.
Lord Gaben and Steam.
Would that one make you transfer over if it came out and it's like 60 frames a second on PC, you know?
Okay,
like,
so
you can't not do it.
If it came out on PS4 and Xbox 360, if Destiny 2 came out on PS4, Xbox 360, and PC, and the only significant difference was that it ran at 30 frames per second on the consoles and 60 on the PC.
Yeah.
I would fucking play it on PC.
Yes.
Oh,
yes.
Everyone document this right now.
I would. I would buy a fucking kick-ass PC and hook up a controller to it and play it that way.
Have Oculus Rift and shit? Like,
I'm fucking freaking out, man.
What? I have a wife?
Dollar fucking whore!
What?
Oh, I love it, man. What happened there? This is fucking crazy.
It's episode 100. That's okay. We can be crazy.
Yeah, we're getting crunk on episode. Hey, we forgot to take our shirts off, but it's too late now. There's a Knack sequel. that's in development for PS4, according to listings on an employee's resume. Robbie, you want to elaborate, my friend?
So they're actually
or not, because nobody cares about this.
They're just making it because it sold well. That's they don't care whether the game was good.
It only sold well because it was one of four games that was released with the PlayStation 4.
I still have it on my shelf collecting dust.
The problem is no one even really liked Knack as a franchise, but they saw that, oh, it sold well. Let's make another one. Well, that's not going to work out because it was mainly because it's a launch title. And Knack Knack is that game that like everyone picks on. He's like the kid in school that everyone likes to make fun of. So he's not going to get
it. It wasn't that bad a game, was it? I don't think it was horrible.
I liked it. I liked it. I just think that it was just it was actually challenging. Like when it got later on in the game, you know what I mean? And plus I put it on my card, but still like it wasn't that bad of a game. Now,
no.
I mean, I don't know. I mean, I'll buy it if it's on sale or something.
I bought it probably a year ago, and I played probably 2 hours and haven't gone back. But I didn't dislike the experience.
Was that still sealed? Was that a sealed game he just showed us? Was it even opened?
He opened it.
Yeah, okay. I beat that shit.
Okay, I thought it was so sealed.
Don't you motherfuckers pick on that? Black
doesn't play a game without beating it. He beats every game he plays. Just in case you don't know.
That's true. I think that is true.
He sure fucking does.
Hey, nope, that's not true. Fallout just fucked that up for me.
Fallout 4.
If they could make some interesting shit happen in that game, I would beat it. But
all right, I think the next we kind of talked about this a little bit, but the next story is pretty interesting. Street Fighter V story mode will take 1 to 2 hours to complete, coming as a free update to the game in June. My question here is, 1 to 2 hours to complete per character?
That's what I was wondering.
One overarching story.
Yeah, we don't know. We don't know. I think it's. I think it's 1 to 2 hours just in general. I don't know, but I have a feeling it's probably pretty short.
Well, I'm thinking it would have to be per character. There's too many characters.
Yeah,
within 1 to 2 hours, I would suspect that it's per character, and that's really good news. I would be interested in playing through that.
Would they do like Mortal Kombat, where they kind of combine all the characters? Like you start on one character, and then it automatically puts you to another character. You think they'll do that?
No,
like one of those story modes.
Not at 1 to 2 hours.
I don't think they could do it with Street Fighter, because Street Fighter does have like really deep character stories behind their characters. Yeah.
Look at Briar. It does, man.
if you read the anime, or if you watch the anime or the manga.
Tell him again, Inner Black.
That's just not in the game. Story.
Hold on, let me go read it on a website.
It's exactly the same situation, though. It's like, that's just not in the game. It's not in any of the games.
Wait,
if you know the deep lore for Street Fighter, you got it off a website. Because it ain't in the game.
I watch all the anime.
Does that annoy you guys at all that, like, I don't know why I was just thinking this, but when Street Fighter came out, I thought, like, when you see the cutscenes, I thought they're going to be animated or something.
Yeah, it's like a comic book picture.
With a voiceover. Yeah. I'm like, yeah.
It does not look professional, guys. I mean, as someone who can actually draw and I'm kind of an artist,
very sad.
Just static images with a voiceover, to me, that was a little disappointing.
Yeah.
You know? I mean, they put a lot of work into the characters, the animation.
You ever notice how corny they make the American characters? Like, the people who are from America are, like, super corny in those games.
Or the black people?
Yeah.
Like, you guys see Birdie?
I don't get what you mean. I feel like they're spot on. Wait, Birdie? I don't get it.
Wait, Birdie's black?
All Brazilians are green and can shoot electricity, right? So as far as I know.
Look at this guy. He's supposed to be a brother. Get the fuck out of here.
He said, "Get the fuck out of here!"
Oh my goodness. Well, I mean,
PlayStation VR is reportedly launching this fall.
I thought we knew that. I thought that's happening.
I thought we did too.
In our minds,
that's good news.
I guess that's people still talking about the NX release. Like, no shit, it's coming out this year. They better hope so, or they better sell Nintendo to somebody.
Hold on. Before you start bullying me, let me just explain this first.
Oh, it's too late for that, Robbie. Sorry.
Damn it.
99 right. Episodes late on that one.
Totally knew. Okay, anyways, no, because the original thing was this is supposed to launch in the first half of this year. Sony said it's going to launch, you know, before like June, around there, like the first half, around spring, summerish. Now an employee at GameStop, or at least the GameStop CEO, is saying that it's going to launch this fall. And I'm wondering how that would impact sales, because of course you've got things like you've got the holiday rush, you've got a lot of parents who are maybe going to want to go buy this for their kids, even though it's probably going to cost a lot. What do you guys think of this? Does this really going
to
impact it?
My question to you guys is, if it comes out, and the NX comes out at the same time, which one are you going to buy? You know what I'm saying?
I'm going to buy the VR.
VR.
Really?
Well, I'll tell you right now. Also, the VR is coming out.
You haven't tried VR, Justin.
Sony's coming out last.
Yeah, but what games are you going to be able to play on it? Nothing, dude. Well, nothing. No Man's Skies? Okay, I'm going to look at some
Knack 2. Knack 2 will be on launch.
Sony's going to be the last team with the VR being announced. So yeah, that would be the last one. There's other companies. Like, there's other ones that are not even well known, like the Oculus, that are actually going to release prices, and they're going to release theirs before. So, like, this gives Sony, like, a chance to
undercut,
undercut people.
That's the thing. We don't know what the price of the Sony VR is, but a lot of people are assuming it's going to be a lot cheaper than the other ones.
Yeah, so, check this out. Yesterday, my older brother, shout out to you, Joe, gave me a call, and he's...
Wait. Your name is Brett, and your brother's name is Joe?
Yeah.
Y'all got some white boy names.
Right on, brother.
Anyway, supposed to be brothers? Fuck that.
He called me, and he used to be a gamer. We grew up playing Super Nintendo all our lives, but as of late, he kind of fell off, and he didn't even know what Oculus Rift was, and so he was watching some reaction videos on YouTube to people playing these games, and he was asking me about PlayStation VR. He's super excited about it. I think that that's pretty much going to be the premise of everybody who's kind of touched VR is going to be in the future. I'm super excited about it. If NX and PlayStation VR came out the same day, I'd be grabbing the PlayStation VR for sure first.
What I'm hoping for from the PlayStation VR is I would like to have like some kind of backward compatibility mode so that games that weren't designed in VR, PlayStation can kind of just like, because it's going to have this like breakout box, right?
Yeah.
That's doing the processing. So I'm kind of hoping that it kind of does that like fake pseudo 3D processing.
Yeah.
So you can play like a game like Destiny or COD Black Ops in VR. I think that'd be really cool.
That would sell it if they come out and they're like every game is going to work. But if they have like say 100 gimmicky titles at launch, there's no way in fuck I'm buying this thing.
That's all they're going to have though. That's all they're going to have.
You can play disc golf in VR. No, I'm good. I don't want to play that shit in VR.
You can play Knack 2 in VR.
I feel like there's like three titles like across the board for all the VR companies that are actually like interesting.
Yeah. Tekken 7 VR.
Not on the list.
But yeah, the good thing is we know it's not gonna be more than $600 because the Oculus is $600, so that's a plus.
Yeah, and you've seen the way the internet blew up on that shit. It's like, we're definitely not doing that.
So
no kidding.
Unless you pre-ordered it like 3 years ago, then you got it for free.
Yeah.
It's gonna be $550. That's a good
I'm hoping that thing comes in at $300 or $400.
Yep.
Like, I can do that.
And even that, I think it's a stretch. Like it's not gonna catch on like wildfire. We might be looking at the first generation of VR. It might be when we get the PlayStation 5, the next generation of consoles and the next generation of, you know, gear and Oculus, that's when things start taking off. They get the manufacturing of this stuff down cheap enough that a real person can afford it, you know? That's when this stuff is going to take off. You know, when CD players and Blu-ray players first came out, they cost thousands of dollars, right? Nobody bought that shit. But once it came out to like $200, $300, then people started acting.
Wait, you said $400. Do you mean like $400 just for the headset? Or you talk about everything? Because you need the whole bundle, you know?
He said max.
Because you need the PlayStation Move, you need the camera. So like,
for a kit, not including the PlayStation 4.
Okay.
But including some games, at least some of those, you know, Mario Tennis type games.
I think that Playroom thing is going to actually happen, where the Playroom ends up being a VR thing also. So if you have it downloaded, there'd be like, oh, like you can demo this bullshit.
Dude, remember
that Playroom sounds interesting.
You remember all the people who are doing that porn stuff like out of the Playroom?
Yeah, there's all these little like eyes flying all over the place. Yes.
Real story, Brian, real quick. You just brought a memory back to me. Years ago, here in Atlanta at a store called Hi-Fi Buys, I don't know if they even still exist. It was a tech store. They had the very first DVD player in there, and it came with the very first DVD, which was Twister. Guess the price of it, guys.
The DVD or the DVD player?
The DVD player with the movie.
$500.
I'm guessing like $1,500, $2,000.
$720. I think it was $729 or $749. for the very first DVD. My first
DVD player cost me $1,000.
Holy hell. Wow. Did you actually spend that much on it?
Yeah.
You be balling back in the day? God damn, man.
My first CD player was a boombox that cost like $200, and it was a piece of shit. I could record tapes off of that shit.
Yeah, I remember that.
And make mixtapes.
Back like, oh, in my song. Hey, this is that song. It's coming on the radio.
Hell yeah. All right, so moving on. I guess the next little bit of news will be exciting for our good friend Inner Black Ninja. Fallout 4's upcoming DLC as part of a season pass has been leaked.
Is it free?
Say what?
Is that free?
Oh, no, they're actually raising the cost of the season pass.
Should be free.
It's being raised from $30 to $50 starting March 1st. Jeez.
So if you buy it now, you're going to save a lot of money on this. Buy it now,
Inner Black.
Or if you don't buy it at all, you'll also save a lot of money.
Does the season pass come with the story? Because then I'll buy it.
Wait, are we talking about Destiny again? Because I feel like you just switched topics.
Yeah, so anyways, there's going to be three major content upgrades. There's going to be the first one in March. It's going to cost $10. It's called Automatron, and it's going to deal with the Mechanist from Fallout 3. He returns, and it says he unleashes his like army of robots onto the Commonwealth, and basically you can kill these robots. You can upgrade and make kind of parts and stuff like that. I mean, that sounds cool. There could be some cool quests with it. Then in April, we have a small piece of DLC that's going to cost $5. It is basically you can – it expands upon the settlements, basically. You can catch and trap things like Deathclaws, Raiders. You can create your own like battle arena. You can have matches and stuff like that. Sounds incredibly cool.
I want to ask you, Robbie, because I know you played the hell out of this game. Did you mess with that stuff at all, the settlement stuff?
I built the hell out of Sanctuary, but other than that, not really.
Okay. I am just giving you guys shit, whoever played this game. I'm fucking around. Don't worry. Don't worry, everyone's gonna have a different opinion. That's why I dig it. So
hey, I played modded version, so that was fun.
Can you mod a story in that motherfucker? Because that's
he's all right. Killing this game.
You know what I have heard is that if you play the PC version, you can get a mod that really fixes the inventory stuff that really helps.
Yeah, because that's some bullshit. Why am I encumbered and I'm carrying like a block of cheese and a brick? Like, come on, dude.
How are you carrying that shit anyway?
Yeah, that's what I mean, dude. I'm trying to sell it. I'm trying to hustle it. Because you
need it to upgrade your settlement. That doesn't make a fucking difference anyway.
I need a minivan. That's what I need in Fallout. I need a minivan just so I can pile all my shit in there.
All right. Final piece of content is coming out in May. It's going to cost $25. Pretty big media expansion called Far Harbor. It's going to have a new story, a new area, new quests, settlements, all kinds of new stuff. This is like the big, massive expansion. So what do you guys think? Will this get you back into Fallout 4, or are you just kind of like,
I didn't finish the game to begin with.
Wait, Robbie. You can buy this now and it's $30, or did they just switch it?
No, you can buy it before March 1st, and it's $30.
The season's pass costs $30 right now. On March 1st, the season pass is going up to $50.
Yeah, so you can buy it now before the increased price. Probably a shit ton of
content, which is probably worth it for those who only have Fallout 4. Maybe you just got a PS4, and it's one of your first games, and you just have been digging deep into it, and that's the kind of game that you like to play and spend hours on. This is probably a good purchase for you. I don't know if I'll ever get into Fallout 4 again. I'm not ever going to say it's a terrible game, it's just a bad game. I don't know how it lost me. I stopped playing it. And then whenever I looked at my PS4 and thought about that game, I felt like it was a chore.
It feels like an old game.
I was like, I don't want to play it. I mean, there's other things for me to play. Yeah. Honestly, to tell the God's honest truth, I had more fun playing Hotline Miami than I ever did playing Fallout 4.
I had more fun playing Fallout 3 than I had playing Fallout 4.
That's
it.
Damn.
That hurts. You guys are a bunch of haters.
Damn. Welcome.
Hold up. Damn.
I'm just keeping it real, pimp.
The Dark Souls 3 Season Pass has been detailed. It will cost $50. The Season Pass will contain two DLC expansions for the game. Those who pre-order the game will also get a free copy of Dark Souls 1 through backward compatibility on Xbox One.
I can't wait to die like a billion times in that game.
Die more in the DLC.
I need my fix of masochism since February's Bloodborne. I haven't really hated myself much lately. Feel like I need to jump right back on that bandwagon.
I can't wait, but I'm still not buying it on Xbox.
I'm getting it on PS4, and more than likely, at some point, Dark Souls 1 will be an Xbox One Games with Gold freebie, because right now, Gears of War 2 is.
Yeah.
And so, you know, that's something. Yeah, I was playing it yesterday.
Is it like that new version of it?
No.
No, it's just the old.
It's the original. It plays perfectly fine, though. It's really great to have that.
We should get everybody together and play that Dark Souls. That'd be dope. Because it's six-player co-op now. So you can roll with a crew of people.
We can all be miserable together. That'd be great. Or we can all have a great big Dark Souls pity party.
We can all suffer from depression together and death.
I'll show you guys how to really play, and then you can be victorious.
Yeah. I'm down. I'm down, Inner Black.
With six players, I mean, better with.
Do you know how hard that game has to be if they allow you to play with six players?
Supposedly the scaling is going to be bananas. They're working on a scaling system. Before, in their old games, it never scaled other than when you were in New Game Plus or when you weren't in New Game Plus. It was always the same. But they're like scaling with all the AI characters, and the bosses have like this thing where, depending on how much, it was called insight for you Bloodborne people. The more insight you have, the boss has changed. In Bloodborne, they're doing the same thing with Dark Souls, to where the bosses will become like wicked beasts instead of knights.
Harder, way harder to be.
Bloodborne was my game.
I didn't know they were doing six players. They're doing that for all versions.
Yeah, all versions, PC too. Yep. I actually heard that from a PC guy that I work with, and then I looked it up and I was like, sure as shit, and it's confirmed for both versions. So
nice.
I'm down. Moving on, guys. Virtual reality could help those with depression, according to a new study. And I'm depressed.
Not if you get match made up against me, motherfucker. You'd be real depressed. You're gonna real bad about yourself. How you got your ass kicked.
Episode 100, everybody. He's empty. He's all out. Time to refill, Brian.
I don't see how that makes sense.
Therapy? I mean, it could be.
My thing is wouldn't you take that off and be like, oh, wait, this is the real world now? You know what I'm saying? It's going to fuck people up more, if anything.
You know what it is? They put the glasses on, and then they have the glasses make you like outside or like around people.
Yeah, no, like I saw the video where they take that old lady that couldn't go outside, and they put the VR on her so she can see the outside. I dig that. That's cool as hell. But after I take those things off, I want to put a bullet in my head. Like I'd be like, what
or
the fuck?
Maybe you just want to go outside. Jesus. You'll meet some people.
Well, no, like if you can't do that, and then they allow you to do it. It's like being an avatar. You know what I'm saying? Maybe like the dude could walk, and then he finds out that he can't. Like what the fuck, man? Well,
I think that's cool. Yeah, like, say, like if someone's on their dying bed, you know what I mean? They got to see one thing they never got to see. You know. Yeah. Yeah, a chick's boob or something like that. You know,
you're 70 years old.
You haven't seen that yet. Oh boy,
you're 70 years old. You're an
98-year-old virgin.
There you go.
Gives you a headset. And you're in an all chick party.
There you go. You see that?
Bikinis and bouncing boobs everywhere.
I've always wanted to see the Ganges River. Like it's always been a dream of mine to get some ass in the Ganges River. And now finally my opportunity is here. My depression has lifted. I mark it off the bucket list.
Or people are going to be like so infatuated with this shit that they don't want to be in the real world. You know what I'm saying?
What was the name of that movie?
Lawnmower Man.
Lawnmower Man. Yeah. You know what's up. Fucking he gets so obsessed with that where he wants to become a part of that universe and doesn't want to be a part of his own universe anymore.
Actually, I was talking about Gamer.
Gamer, same deal. Yeah.
You guys remember that?
Yeah, unfortunately, I do.
Butler, or whatever the hell his name is.
Unfortunately, I do remember that.
All right, so anybody want to continue on with some of this other news?
Techland teases more content coming to Dying Light at least until the end of this year, thanks to fan support. So,
damn.
People obviously are supporting Dying Light. The newest DLC came out, right?
Yeah.
It must have sold well because they're going to make more. Like they're saying, hey.
And that would be also included in this too, because by buying the following, you bought the season pass version of it technically.
So that's good news, man. I mean, I like to see companies making successful products based on things people enjoy. Yeah, it's great.
It costs money to make games, and if you make a good game, people are going to continue to support it. And that's a game I have, but I still haven't fucking played it.
Yeah, especially Dying Light.
I thought you played that for a
while. No, I'm talking about the new DLC, the following.
Yeah.
I mean, I think developers like this and even like CD Projekt Red, they've shown incredible respect to their fan base and they've really cared and they said, thank you for playing our game and we want to give back to you. And I think stuff like this is just awesome. It really is. And they've even had like free updates and new content. And it's just like, that's so awesome. I love when devs do this. I really do. It's not something you always see, but it's super appreciated.
Bethesda Game Studios is working on three new projects, says studio director Todd Howard. Anybody have any idea
what Fallout those games might be? Fallout 4, New England.
Better be a new Wolfenstein.
Elder Scrolls 6, Fallout 5,
what about,
Fallout
What about 6. The Shinji Mikami game? I think that's something they're working on.
No, this is just Bethesda Game Studios. This isn't the publisher, though. This is who made Fallout 4. It's just that studio. So basically what they said is, Todd Howard said that they're working on three new projects. Obviously, they don't really know what they are yet, but they said they're doing similar things to what we've done before. They're going to be big open games, but they're also going to be something new and very different.
They're working on the real Fallout 4, and they're working on Skyrim Remastered. I bet you Skyrim Remastered is one of them. I'd put money on that shit because they'd be idiots not to.
They haven't remastered anything yet, though, Inner Black. They need to.
Why
you
not?
Have to realize they had like 5 years of working on these three games because they definitely weren't working on Fallout that much. So they have plenty of time to work on these games. So, I mean.
They were like, wait, our game doesn't run? Yeah, make another copy of that and put it on the next system.
Quick, put it out. Sell more copies. Got to print money.
Well, anybody read iRobot? Put that story in there. It'd be great. But
hey, you know what? I give respect to Bethesda because when you go out of your comfort zone and try something new, I think that's always
awesome. What the fuck?
They didn't do anything.
Oh, yeah, Fallout 4 was way outside of comfort zone.
No, I'm saying whatever they're working on now, they're doing something different. Shut up, guys.
Yeah. Dude. No. Wow, dude. Wow.
I'm saying with these new projects, they're going to try something different.
He straight up, he's like, you guys are assholes. I hate you all.
I'm just trying to give them respect, and you guys are like, fuck you. I'm like, wow.
Bethesda didn't make Wolfenstein, right? They just published it.
Machine games did.
Whoever made that fucking game, they need to make another one of those.
Yeah, I'll take another one of those. That was a good game. That
was amazing.
Yeah, that was super fun.
I bet you money that'll be announced at E3. I think it's been enough time.
You think they're going to make another Evil Within?
Yeah, that's what I was talking about. They have to.
Yeah,
probably
that game sold really, really well. It was kind of an underwhelming experience, in my opinion.
Story-wise, it was like, what the fuck is going on?
And it had some pretty clunky controls, too. You know,
I was going to say, I agree. The technical part of it needs to be fixed.
It needed
that was the one that was, like, super widescreen. It was like a strip of video like this wide.
Yeah, that game was actually developed for 7th-generation consoles initially, and then they changed it mid-development cycle and upgraded to PS4. So it had some technical hiccups to overcome. Oops. Yeah, oops. I would like to see what they do with it next, though. Shinji Mikami is awesome.
They're making Wet. That's what they're making. It's Wet.
No, the hell they're not.
Fake-ass Tarantino video game.
You guys are a bunch of dicks.
That we are. It took you 100 episodes to figure that out.
I love you guys to death, but
I think that might be the title of this show. Episode 100. You guys are a bunch of dicks.
Please don't do that. I want people to watch.
It's already done. Quantum Break, a game I'm excited for, has gone gold. The game will launch on Xbox One and PC on April 5th. You guys excited about this game? Anybody worried about it?
I was not excited about this game at first, but like the latest trailer that they had the game itself, like to me it made it look like I was actually excited for it. You know, that's when I actually went to pre-order it. And I'm gonna get on PC to be safe, and then I might get on Xbox One because I'm sure I have a feeling they're gonna put more extra content. I don't think they announced it, but I'm pretty sure they're gonna try to do something.
Why don't you just pre-order on Xbox One? You get the PC version for free.
Yeah.
You gotta keep in mind, I'm probably gonna download for PC for like $18, so it's really not that much of a loss. And if I'm not gonna buy an Xbox One, if I turn out that I don't need it, I won't pay anything. I only paid $18 rather than paying $60 guaranteed. You know what I mean? So like, that's the reason why. That's the thing, like, even though the deal is good, majority of people are only gonna buy it from one platform anyway. So like,
how would you even get it that cheap though? I don't even think like GTA and stuff sells it nearly that cheap.
Like,
it
would be more like 50. With a coat.
There's ways, but Sorry, Microsoft.
You're being super sketchy about this.
Sorry, Microsoft.
You're really dodging my question.
No, but it is paid for legally, just to someone else. But anyway.
Legal money.
Yes.
Illegal transaction.
Wait a second. Right. Microsoft owns Skype too. Damn it. Ah!
What?
Microsoft owns Skype as well.
Where are we going with
I reserved this? That game probably like 5 months ago or 6 months ago, so I'm super hyped for it. I've been hyped for it since I seen the first trailer. The actual gameplay trailer, not the shit where it was CG imaging, like the one where he was
that game trailer was good.
Yeah, when he came from the building to the outside and there was like a helicopter, fucking amazing. That I'm sorry.
Nice. That game was what I wanted Infamous Second Son to be, man.
Yeah.
It looks like
the only thing that concerns me about this game to begin with is the whole episode TV bullshit that they're trying to do. I don't watch television, okay? I fucking hate everything on TV for the most part. I don't watch anything. I'm not a TV guy. And if I have
to get
into
the latest episodes of Project Runway, I mean, they're going places that are mind-blowing.
No, and I'm saying, like if you have to watch a TV show in order to fill in the story of this fucking game, what is that shit, you know?
Well, the thing is,
might as well go to a website.
Yeah.
I'm not the biggest TV guy either, right? My wife, she watches a show every other day. And for me, this is a step in a different direction. It might actually work. You know, they got some talented people here. The game looks phenomenal. It looks like it plays well. And if the decisions you make in the game actually matter in the scope of the show, it's only 4 episodes. So
that
it's not
would
like
be
a,
cool if it did that. Like
that's
where,
it does.
Where the Are you 100% sure?
Yes.
I'm not
yes,
talking I'm about like the Walking Dead choice. Oh, the choice is matter. The choice doesn't fucking matter, man.
The show it supposedly has 2 dynamic endings for each episode and multiple different changes throughout the episode. So
okay.
There's going to be things, that you can find throughout the episode that can change what characters might do or say. But there's an ultimate end. There's 2 ultimate ends to each episode that you can come
to. Do you guys like that Max Payne? Like element too, because I feel like you know that. Like it kind of reminds me of Max Payne a little bit. We're starting some of the things it does in the game, like which is not a bad thing. Cause I always love that like slow motion effect and all that stuff. Like I don't mind it.
Game is beautiful, man. It's beautiful.
I dig it if you make your game look amazing. You know what I'm saying? That game looks so good, and when they slow mo everything, all the particle effects and all that shit stay there. You know, it's not all like poppy and look like shit. So if you can do it that way, which who knows if they're showing PC footage when they showed it? Who knows? No one's gonna know. But
good thing we get both versions, right?
Yeah, but you get both versions. So if you don't like the version you're playing, go buy a PC.
I'm excited for this game, man. I'll be picking it up. I got my pre-order in, and I'm more excited to see the stark contrast between the Xbox One and the PC if it's even noticeable. You know, I'm gonna check that out because as a person who's never really been a PC gamer, I'm starting to feel the burn of the PC nowadays.
Yeah. Did you get one of those hubs yet? The hub to make your controller so you can wireless? Yeah. It works money, dude, for the Xbox One remote.
Oh,
so you don't
really
need to plug it in? Yeah, it's amazing. There's like a sync button on it. You just sync your controller and you can play it. Fuck that. Throw that shit in the dumpster.
I've been I don't have as many buttons as not too nerdy, but I got a couple of them, damn it.
Dude. Pick a mouse. I got plenty of them.
He got plenty of mouses.
I got mice.
Briar, pick a mouse.
Way to go, Briar.
That's a high-end gaming mouse right there.
Apple thing doing that.
Look at that.
DPS what?
I got another one, too.
There you go. That's better.
All right, guys. So finishing out our little bit
is
of
that a razor?
100. Gears of War 4 will be a graphical showcase for Xbox One, says project lead Rod Ferguson. It already looked like it was when they showed us a little trailer, the intro trailer. What do you guys think about Gears of War? You guys excited for this game?
I like Gears of War, so I am kind of excited. I like these games.
When they showed that, I was like, this shit is so dark, I can't see what the fuck is going on. Like,
could
you tell what was going on?
I know.
But
I could see it during that trailer. It looked pretty foreboding. I didn't have any issue with it. As somebody who was kind of late to the Gears of War party, you guys knew this a year and a half ago. I never really got into Gears of War. Actually, Gears of War 2 yesterday was my first time ever playing it.
Really?
Wow.
Yeah. Holy shit, it's awesome. It is really, really awesome. Never played the Gears of War, I forget the one that they just released in 2013, which was kind of a fail. But the what I saw of Gears of War 4 looked foreboding. It looked creepy, and it looked beautiful graphically. So I'm excited.
I always liked the Gears of War games. I thought they were done well. They were graphically pretty cool looking. They had a pretty, I thought, original world and like enemy, and it was fun. It was just a fun world to be in. It's kind of campy and like these big hulking dudes with like, you know, never worn helmets. And you know, by the end of it, you actually felt attached to some of the characters. So when
episode 100.
There you go.
Oh, we got a baby.
The new recruit to the Beastly Thought Show.
So she got the same haircut as her daddy.
Yep. Yeah. That's how you know
she's my kid. She's beautiful, man. Way to go, Justin. For the guys who don't know, Inner Black Ninja was a staple of the show for a very long time. He took a few months hiatus because he became a new dad. And once he figured out how to change those diapers with one hand, he came back to us. That is the product of his hard work, and it looks like he worked really hard, Justin. Beautiful baby.
That is beautiful.
Thing I like about Gears, I think Gears did the third-person shooter the best, like the button layout. I think like they're the ones that I think every third-person shooter since then try to imitate them. Like they all do that shaky cam when someone's running. They all try
to haloed it, right? They kind of made a control scheme and a system of cover, and
it's cool. I mean, it just feels really, really good, man.
Before them, it was only like, I guess SOCOM was like the one that everyone looked up to like imitate for third person shooter. But then all of a sudden when Gears of War came out, like it's more about that style. Cause that actually was the first system when you go to a ledge to take cover, like you could actually differentiate the buttons between to vault over and take cover, because
that used to piss me off back then too.
Yeah. They always used to have the same button to control like cover and jump over, and like sometimes you'll try to do one, it'll do the other. And I think Gears of War is the first one to actually had the best button layout for third person shooter.
No, I will say this, right? I had my PS3 well before I had an Xbox One, and I actually went over a friend's house, Donnell, shout out, two shots, one video. And he had Gears of War Xbox 360.
That's such a black guy thing.
You're damn right. What up, Shaniqua? All right.
Shout out.
You just fucking called me Shaniqua. Meyer Black Street Ho now?
He had Gears of War for the Xbox 360. I'd never saw it before, and he was playing it, and I didn't tell him because I was full of pride for my PlayStation. But it was one of the most graphically stunning games I'd ever seen at that time. And it looked heads and shoulders above anything I'd seen on the PlayStation 3. And so Gears of War kind of was a paradigm shift for Microsoft in the console space. And if they're really thinking this, or at least quoting them, saying that it's going to be a graphical showcase, I believe that it just might be for the Xbox One. Because, you know, now I own everything. And I can be, you know, I'm not going to show bias towards anybody. The Xbox 360, when it came to Gears of War, when that game was released, it was graphically one of the best-looking games at that time.
Yeah.
It could very easily do the same thing again with the Xbox One. I don't know if we've ever seen a developer create an exclusive for the Xbox One that really pushes the envelope for the console yet.
Are they using the cloud for this? Do you know?
I have no clue.
The cloud?
Mysterious cloud.
Yeah, the cloud. I don't know what
Oz. We'll just call it Oz.
Don't forget, though, this is also the first time we're seeing a different developer for Gears of War. So that's another thing we have to remember.
A friggin' motherfucking Canadian developer. Yeah.
Yeah, that's what's scary about it.
That's scary. That's going to make it awesome.
That's why.
There's going to be Molson Golden all up in this.
You're going to announce to get your exclusive Moose Rider DLC as well.
Moose Rider DLC? Yeah, I'm looking forward to Gears of War, man, and getting my gears on. You guys, in the mind state that you might be picking up Gears of War when it releases, are you guys fans of the series?
Yeah, I've always enjoyed them.
From what they showed at E3, like Gears of War 4 does look really good, and I'm really looking forward to it. I just want to see more of it first, because I feel like that was when the game was a year and a half out, and I feel like now it's been developed so much longer. I can't wait to see what they've done and how it's coming.
What I saw in the trailer for this game was, which kind of made me excited, as they're taking it more, it feels more kind of like a survival horror.
Oh no, not again!
Action adventure game. That's what.
I think your wife's on you porn again, man.
You guys hear me?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Kind of.
Oh shit, buddy. What I was saying was, in that trailer, what I took from the trailer was that
it looked more like a survival horror aspect of Gears of War. The way that they were walking down this dark corridor, and there was, I can't tell if you guys are laughing because you can't hear me, or if you're laughing because of what just happened.
We're laughing because of what just happened.
I'm a good little boy.
You're good. Talk quick.
Okay. Anyway, it felt really scary to me, and I appreciate that feeling. I like being scared, and watching that trailer and watching this this mercenary or this soldier looking for this creature in the dark just was kind of a creepy feel. And the game looked beautiful to me. You said it was a little dark to you, Inner Black. To me, it looked really awesome.
I hope they do that with it, because it would be very refreshing, because all the other Gears weren't like directed as a horror-based game. You know, it was like, okay, it was more like Tremors than horror. Yeah. You know, it's like, hey, there's some shit attacking us. Let's put bullets in them. You know, yeah, bro, Mountain Dew, bro. Like that's how it was, and it was kind of cheesy, and I'd like a more serious vibe to it. It was like New Age Duke Nukem in a sense, the way these fuckers talk to one another, you know?
Razor Hail.
Yeah.
I'm looking for
Full Train. Like, shut the fuck up.
The only thing that Sony can do to combat the Gears of War train is release another Resistance game. Resistance.
That's not even close to the same level.
I love Resistance.
Resistance 3 was one of the best games as far as story and action goes that I played in a long time.
You are riding the Sony pony right now.
Yeah.
If you think that the Resistance series, they were close to the Gears of War series, you are on track.
But you got to keep in mind, Briar, I said I never really got into it.
Exactly. Know? That's why your opinion doesn't fucking matter on this.
I played every Resistance, every Gears, and I could honestly say I would rather play any fucking Gears game over any Resistance game.
If you're saying third-person shooter mechanics, that it's not the same as Gears, then I would choose, if SOCOM came back like that, then it'll be SOCOM. A lot of people like SOCOM third-person shooting.
Yeah, you know, yeah, your head's in the clouds, though, if you think SOCOM's coming back.
Yeah, but I'm just saying, like, that's the only thing I could see, that if you want to talk about third person versus third person that could actually compete, because I know a lot of people, before Call of Duty, it was all about SOCOM. So that was the game that people played. So really,
I could see them bringing H-Hour to the console. That's all I could see them doing.
They're talking about possibly porting it over to the PS4, but that's just been talked for months. So, but it looks good. It looks cool.
Yeah,
it looks like SOCOM. And that's that.
Is that our last news story? Man, episode 100.
What a doozy.
Up and down, very up and down.
The Simpsons did it. No,
I got some tech issues I definitely got to work out. I think we got to find a way to record the episode separate of Twitch, because in the past, I've been using Google Hangouts to just record the episode, and I don't think doing that with Twitch is going to be as reliable. So we might have to figure out a secondary way of recording.
You can do OBS. Just go on OBS. You can record locally, and you can record it like that, locally.
I don't know if my computer can handle recording, doing Skype and doing Twitch at the same time.
Holy shit!
I think I could do it.
Couldn't someone just capture it?
Yeah.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Like have it up on your screen and capture the whole thing?
I don't know. I can try recording while I'm streaming and doing the Skype conversation. I don't know if I can do all three at the same time.
OBS was giving me trouble last week. I told you, Brian.
OBS gives everybody trouble. Yeah.
So maybe if you talk me through it, I could do it. This PC is an animal, so.
Yeah, we'll figure it out. We're going to discuss it quite a bit. But yeah.
But man, whew, episode 100, 100 episodes.
It's in the books.
Can we get to 110, Briar? I doubt it.
I don't know. Not at this rate.
Before then. At least you guys, because you guys are pretty old. So
I don't know if my liver can handle it.
I'm good, though. Yeah, I'm fine.
Oh, my God. I missed the 18-year-old Robbie, you drunk. Shut up.
Drunk, shut up.
Anybody got anything they want to pimp out this week?
Oh, I'm doing a 12-hour long stream on Saturday.
Oh, really? Straight. So this upcoming Saturday, what are you doing? Yeah.
I'm playing everything. I'm just going to – my buddy's helping me with OBS, and then once I get that all situated, which will probably be tonight or tomorrow, and then I'm just going to have all my systems hooked up and just run whatever games I feel like playing.
Why are you doing 12 hours? Just for fun? Just
to try to get a 12-hour? I got time.
Oh, the wife's gone. I got you.
Say no more. We know.
Yeah. I'm going to be playing for 12 hours straight anyway. Might as well
– Yeah, might as well stream it. Shit, yeah, that's the way I look at it. So I'll be playing like all a bunch of like I'm getting Far Cry obviously, and then I'll be playing some of that, some Street Fighter if it works, I should say.
Hey, you know, 12 hours is just enough time to get back into Fallout 4, Enter Black Ninja. Man.
No, it's not actually.
Or it's enough time. Or it's enough time to play something with a better story.
That's enough time to figure out how to hook up power to your settlement.
Yeah. Dude, I could play two games in that time, and they'll probably be a hell of a lot better than Fallout.
General, another settlement needs some help. God, I got sick of hearing that.
It did take me a long time to figure that shit out, Briar. The generator right here.
Yeah. Oh, dude. Oh my God. That's that fucking up. Part, dude. I was like, what the fuck am I missing? I'm sitting there. I'm like, all right, everything's done.
I got the wire going from the generator to the light bulb. There's only one fucking thing on this generator.
Yeah, I'm like, I had to
search it up, too.
They have the most wonky-ass fucking HUD I've ever seen in my life. Their HUDs on that game, all their HUDs and their displays, they need to fix all that shit.
With the collector's edition, you could actually buy like the wrist thing.
Yeah,
and put your cell phone in there and have that HUD in your entire life. You could always have it.
I don't want it. I want to mod that shit. Come out with a mod for that.
Have your GPS looking like a Fallout map. You gotta set waypoints.
And they'd be like, you can't travel here. You can't travel here. You're in a fight. I'm not in a fucking fight. What are you talking about?
You driving in the car, game. It's like you are over encumbered.
Fucking Fallout.
Coming from a buffet? Like, yeah, I'm over encumbered. You're damn right.
What I'm going to be doing this week, guys, is probably going a little bit of retro. I just recently got the old Elgato HD back. If you guys remember, about a year ago, my daughter broke it, my original Elgato, and I bought a 60. So now I got two. And that's going to
be would you send it out for repair or something?
No, it's still bought here. It's just broken. I bought another one. Oh. But I'm going to be recording some Dreamcast games, some Sega Saturn stuff, some Nintendo 64 stuff, some Dreamcast. I'm really looking forward to that. And it'll be on the channel this week. I got all my videos already done for the week. That feels good. And it'll just be another week of gaming in the books. Episode 100. I want to say, guys, I started this show a long time ago. Briar, you've been with me since. Briar, you've been with me since episode 2. God damn it. Episode 2. And you guys came very shortly thereafter. And this has turned into a very, very important part of my life and an awesome, awesome show. I couldn't ask for a better group of friends. You guys mean the world to me. Thank you all so much. And I'm going to be here until the very end of this. That means when my hair falls out, my balls fall off, that'll be the last episode. And
that went into a weird place.
It doesn't happen. Oh, no. Okay,
they kind of get lower as you age. I don't think they actually fall off.
Okay, so when I run and you hear tick-tock, but I'll be here to the end. I'm so happy that you guys are all here. Hector, thank you so much, man. Robbie, of course you know it. I'm sure Briar knows just how important you are to this show. Inner Black, thank you. Now you got the dynamics of that diaper changing down, and I'm sure that we will see you every week. Thank you guys so much. Yeah, and thank you to everybody who's been watching this show and being
Man, your support means everything. It's really great to see like all those views, all those likes at the end of the week. You know, people like this show, and you know, we like making it. So thank you for hanging out there. Now that we're streaming on Twitch, it'll be great to see you guys, you know, come back week after week. We got new followers today, SuperDan1989. Thank you very much.
Thank you guys so much.
He actually hosted our stream as well to his channel.
Oh, thank you.
Which gained us some new viewers. ReaperHD24, thank you very much for following. DRL23, Primark Horus, thank you all for following the channel. And being a part of the Beastly Thoughts Live family.
Yeah. And we'll be here for 101.
Maybe.
For sure.
If I can get this, don't fall over.
If I can get Skype to work properly.
Damn you, Skype.
Yeah. Before we go, I want to give a shout out to Kadika and Briar for for actually inviting me over. Because like before this, I was doing another podcast a long time ago when I first started on YouTube, And, you know, since then, like, I haven't done a podcast or anything, so I was definitely having a lot of fun here and stuff like that. And I meant to say, you know, not Kadeka, I'm sorry, Beastly, you know. I know
I thought you were joking. I was like, oh, he's just messed up.
But, that was my name before the sex change, guys. Go ahead.
Google that image.
Yeah, so definitely, you know, I had a lot of fun on the show and stuff like that. So, but if you guys are interested, hopefully this week Beastly will actually do some cross dungeons with me in Blade and Soul. I'm going to be live streaming that on Twitch. So, and I'm also going to be doing an unboxing video. I got different accessories, you know, that I'll show off a little bit and I'll do a review. But it definitely helps me play the MMO a lot better, which is something I never thought I'd actually say. I play MMO, you know, I'm not
MMO
type of person, but this is like, doesn't feel like that. You know, it does have some elements to it that's like, I would have to say.
Traditional.
Yeah, it's like something unique in a way. Like, I don't know.
It's because it's cool. All the other MMOs are lame as hell.
Yeah.
He summed it up right there, Hector.
Yeah.
You're Blade a fucking ninja, fucking awesome. Dog. You can't fuck up being a ninja.
Yeah. You see the outfits of these chicks wearing this game? I was going to spend $20 on one. It's just a fucking t-shirt. Jesus Christ.
Don't do it. Don't give in. Don't buy the Hotline Bling fucking dancer.
Hector, I'll play with you. I'm going to actually play after we get done with the show. I'll just shoot you a text and get your name, and we can do that.
I have it downloaded. I don't know where you guys are playing, though.
If you guys want to play, my name's Master Nerdy. Just saying.
Gotcha. It's very scary and funny at the same time.
My profile picture is Carlton Banks dancing. And if you guys want to know how to do that, I can show you how to do that. It's actually a technique. But I found out a way to put any gifts you want on there. So, you know, we could do that.
Wow. Sick. Okay. So, is anybody else doing anything special this week, Briar? Robbie?
You know what I do.
Okay.
I do the same thing.
This week, I'm probably just going to be playing a lot of Far Cry Primal because I love Far Cry and I love that this one is set in the Stone Age. I bet it's going to be an awesome game and I'm super looking forward to it. But pretty much, I just want to take this moment to say from the bottom of my heart, all of you guys, Briar, Beastly, Inner Black, Not Too Nerdy, thank you all so much for being great co-hosts and good friends. Like, I really love doing this show with all of you, and it means a lot. Even for all the people that watched, seriously, thank you so much, because episode 100, this was a big day for us and a big new beginning for the show. We just switched formats. We got a lot of things on our plate right now, but this is really
lot of things we got to fix for episode 101.
Yes, this is just the beginning, but I hope you guys are going to stick along with us because we got a long road ahead and things are good. So thank you all so much. It really means the world to me.
The feels.
Yeah, the feels right now. I'm getting a little emotional. Look at Inner Black. He's looking down. He's like,
he put his hat down so he could cry.
I was texting.
Sure you were. Yeah. Thank you, guys.
All right. Are we good? Anybody else got anything else?
Good.
No.
All right. I think that's going to do it then. Thanks to everybody for watching.
That was creepy.
If you missed the beginning of the show, it will not be on YouTube probably because it was a complete mess.
This is rough,
but I'll see what I can do anyway. Thanks for watching. I guess that's it. I'm going to stop the stream. Thanks for hanging out. I don't know how to end it.
See you guys next
awkward.
Week.
Awesome kind of this day, awkward. Everybody.
See you later.
Outro. Bye.
See you.
Yeah.
Look at Dave just voguing.
Hey, Briar. I think for episode 100, what you should do is show some highlights of this. But then show like highlights of different episodes, like, and just say for episode 100. So just like highlights of different episodes that we had on there, and that's it. Like,
that's a good idea, but man, it requires so much work.
I mean, I can help. I need help for some. But I mean, no, just like grab different pieces from every episode. It doesn't have to be, I mean, not every episode, but like some episodes. Like,
I got to roll, guys. I got to go make dinner. So
all right, man.
I got a hungry wife. All right,
Justin.